Hi everybody, let's continue to talk about analysis of variance, but this time let's talk about what we do after we find a statistically significant omnibus ANOVA. Remember, the omnibus ANOVA is the overall analysis of variance that simply checks to see if at least some difference exists. If we find a statistically significant omnibus ANOVA, we know that differences do exist, so now we need to figure out which groups differ. And to do that, we will compute post-tests. So we can ask ourselves the question, when do we need to do post-tests? Well, anytime we've rejected the null hypothesis for the omnibus test, and we have three or more groups. Remember, I did mention that we could use ANOVA to compare two groups. If the overall test found statistically significant differences, then we know those two groups differ. But if we have three groups, or four groups, or five groups, and the overall test is statistically significant, we don't yet know exactly which groups differ, so we need to do the post-tests. There are many different post-tests that exist. We are going to focus on Fissures LSD. That stands for least significant difference. Some people call it protected T. It is a modified T-test, so it's going to be easy for us to do. Most of these post-tests do what we call pairwise comparisons, and it's simply looking at all pairs of groups compared. So for example, in this first ANOVA that we did, if we were doing pairwise comparisons, we would need to form all pairs among those three groups. So we would need to compare the cold room with the comfortable room, the cold room with the hot room, and then the comfortable room with the hot room. Those are all the pairs that exist. As I mentioned, there are several different types of post-tests. Let me just show you with SPSS. Right here, I can click on post hoc, post tests, and you can see there's a large list. There are like more than 15 there that we can pick from. Very first one is Fissures LSD. Other commonly used post tests are known as the Bonferroni test, the Chaffee test, Tukey's test. These are usually named after the statistician who created the test. So if we're doing pairwise comparisons, if we're simply comparing two groups at a time, why don't we just do normal t-tests? Well, keep in mind, every time we do a test, there's a risk of a type 1 error. And what we want to try to do is keep that alpha level, the risk of a type 1 error, at 0.05, 5% across the entire experiment. So in other words, when we do all these post-tests, we don't want the alpha level experiment-wise to grow above 5%. So good post-tests do something to try to control that alpha level to keep it at 5% across all the comparisons that we need to do. You'll see that we're computing a t-test. That t-test is formed pretty much just like the independent samples t-test that we learned previously, except instead of pulling the variance and then using that in the denominator of the equation, you see we are putting in instead the mean square within groups. Remember, mean square is just variance. The mean square within groups from our overall ANOVA. When we stick that into that equation, that turns into a T for the Fissures LSD, otherwise known as protected T. How are we going to find a critical value for it? No problem. We're going to use the degrees of freedom within groups from that overall analysis of variance. Let me show you what I mean. Remember this first ANOVA example that we worked on. We set up our test, we figured out how much evidence we would need. We would need an F value above and beyond 3.88 to find statistically significant results. When we computed that F ratio, we found a very large value, 11.28. So that clearly exceeded our critical value, and we found statistically significant results. Because our results are statistically significant, it makes sense that we're going to do post-tests to figure out where the differences actually exist. Here was all the information that we computed to get to that F ratio, and we're going to need some of that information to compute our Fissures LSD post-test. So let's get on to that. Let's move over to step five. So we need to decide if post-tests are necessary. We decided that because we rejected the null hypothesis with our overall omnibus test, at least one group does differ from another. So we need these post-tests. We have to determine which two groups to compare first. This example is just a little bit odd because we have two groups with the exact same mean. So I'm looking for the biggest difference. So let's first just simply decide to compare the 70 degree room with the 90 degree room. So we have a mean of 4 versus a mean of 1. So coming back over here, it says right here that first we're going to compare those two groups, 70 degrees versus 90 degrees. Now, when we do this test, we're going to stick in those two means, 4 and 1. So mean group 1, mean group 2, the two groups we're comparing. We will compare 4 and 1. We have to know how many people are in each group. We had 5 people in each group. There were 5 in the comfortable room, 5 in the hot room. And as I mentioned, in this formula, instead of having pooled variance in here, we're going to have another measurement of variance, mean square within groups. So I come back to where I did the omnibus ANOVA, and I look to see what is the value of mean square within groups. And that value is 1.33. So that goes into the numerator of each one of these fractions. So ultimately, our equation is going to look like this. Let's just go ahead and finish out that equation. I'll work it out with you. Of course, in the numerator right here, 4 minus 1 equals 3. Let's figure out how we get from this step to this step right here. So I like to handle each fraction one at a time and then add them together. So I would take 1.33, divide that by 5. That equals about 0.27. Again, we'll just round a little bit to 2 decimal places. You see, this is the same fraction, 1.33 divided by 5. So we're left with 0.27 plus 0.27. Let's add those up. That equals 0.54. And remember, I need the square root of this. You can see the radical sign. So I'm going to hit my square root key. And that equals about 0.73. So that's where we got this value right here. So now we need 3 divided by 0.73. And that equals a t value of about 4.11. All right, so that's our obtained t value. When we're comparing the comfortable room to the hot room, that difference can be expressed as this t value, 4.11. So we have to figure out now, is that a statistically significant difference? Well, we want to compare that value with a critical t value. And this is the critical t value that we're going to use. Where does that come from? Remember, in this equation, we are focusing on mean square within groups. In this situation, we're going to want to focus on degrees of freedom within groups from our overall analysis of variance. We had 12 degrees of freedom within groups in that analysis. So in a t table, we are going to want to look up 12 degrees of freedom. Let's go ahead and do that right now. We are going to want to find an alpha of 0.05 for a two-tail test. Degrees of freedom is listed right here. We want to scroll down until we find 12 degrees of freedom. So now we know what row to focus on. We need to come over and find the right column. This is the column for 0.05 two-tailed. So this is the value that we need, 2.179, plus or minus 2.179. This obtained t value clearly exceeds 2.179. So we can conclude that there's a statistically significant difference in the learning performance when you compare the people in the comfortable room and the hot room. And we were able to find that the people in the comfortable room outperformed the people in the hot room. Now we go back and we look at our means and we figure out what's the next biggest difference. Well, we can also compare the people in the comfortable room and the people in the cold room. They differ just as much as the people in the comfortable room and the hot room. So this analysis is actually going to be exactly the same, and you can see it results in exactly the same t value. So again, we can conclude that the people in the comfortable room outperform the people in the cold room. Now again, what makes this example kind of interesting is the last pair that we can compare would be the people in the cold room and the people in the hot room. And you see they have the exact same mean. Their performance was exactly the same. If they have exactly the same means, there's no way that they can differ. And that's exactly what we find. When we stick in those means for our t-test, we have 1 minus 1, which equals 0 in our numerator. So we find a t-value of 0 that reflects the difference between those two groups. Of course, 0 does not exceed our critical value of 2.179, so that difference is not statistically significant. Before we move on to step 6 and interpret our results, put it all together, let me just point out a couple things to you. There are several trends that emerge that make this analysis actually very easy. First of all, Because we're doing a T test, Fissures LSD is a modified value of T. We are looking up a critical value in our T table, and that critical value applies to all the different pairwise comparisons we do. You'll also notice that the denominator is the same in every one of our analyses. So even though we might be comparing two different groups, this denominator is always the same, 0.73, 0.73, 0.73. So once we compute it once, we already know what the value will be in the other equations. So that makes it easier. There's really not a lot of work that we need to do. We're just comparing two means. We compute the denominator. That value will be the same regardless of the number of means we need to compare. So let's put that all together in step six. And here's how I would interpret that. We want to make it clear what post-test we used because, as I mentioned before, there are many. So I'm going to begin by saying Fissures LSD was performed to identify specific group differences. And I like to keep my writing short, so I kind of put as much together in one sentence as possible. So Fissures LSD was performed to identify specific group differences, revealing that the 70 degree group performed better than the 90 degree group and the 50 degree group. And you can see within there, I put the results of the t-test. So remember, we had 12 degrees of freedom. So I'm putting t with 12 degrees of freedom equals the value that we computed, 4.11. Because it was statistically significant, I'm listing that p is less than 0.05. And it just so happens that the two comparisons we did that are statistically significant had the exact same t value. So that makes this particular example somewhat unique. And then finally, they were both based on two-tailed tests. These t-tests that we're doing are two-tailed tests. We looked up a two-tailed critical value. So when I write it up down here, I make sure I list two-tailed. Remember how things work in our class when we learn something new. It feels a little bit odd at first, but once we get a little bit of practice, it feels much better. That's enough for this particular video, but in the next video, we will do the post-tests for ANOVA example number 2. I'll see you in that next video. Take care.